Reading the Word of God, Revelation and John 11. And I heard a voice from heaven saying, write this, blessed are the dead who die in the Lord from now on. Blessed indeed, says the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors, for their deeds follow them. I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. Amen. Please be seated.
and to welcome you all here this afternoon as we commemorate and celebrate the life of Mr. Selvin Sidi. We also have viewers across the world who are connected by YouTube. And so we just want to welcome them as well. Before I go on, there are a few house rules. As you know, during this COVID time, we have to be COVID aware. So in terms of if we need to use the toilets, we've got hand gel, hand foam in terms of sanitizing. The toilets themselves are through these doors on my left, which is your right, and down the corridor on the right-hand side, there are two sets of toilets. In case there is a fire, we will follow the arrows through this door on my left and follow the arrows out through the door, which is at the back. And the meeting place will be convened at the gates where the cars have been parking. And in terms of actually leaving the premises, the family have asked if you could file past the actual casket and then follow the same routes that we would follow as if we were in a fire drill, which is the exit out the back here. In terms of singing, we will be led by the chorister, Sister Naomi, and there will be no singing from the actual congregation. Keep a song in your heart. Thank you very much.
Please come stand for the opening hymn.
Bright as bright.
Good afternoon, everybody. I think you all know us, but we are the immediate family of Selwyn and Sylvester Seeley. And we're doing the eulogy. My dad and mum knew each other in Barbados as they attended the same college. My dad was a mature student. It was a private college and mum had won a scholarship to attend for her early teens. The principal of the college was Seventh-day Adventist and the college was his. The Adventist ethos where the rule was the law of the day. Mum said that Dad was different in his conduct from the other students and didn't know that he was Seventh-day Adventist Christian like the principal. He lived up to the Adventist ethos. When he came to England in June 1966, he didn't know that Mum was already here just a couple of months before him. He came over here to train as a psychiatric nurse, mental health nurse. He realised that Mum was over here through his cousin, Verna, who met Mum, on the same flight coming over. They became close friends. It was when my dad called her up to arrange to visit his cousin that he got to know that Mum, who attended the same college as him, was over here and he had become close friends with his cousin. When he visited his cousin, Mum was off duty as well, and being in the same sect as his cousin. Dad and Mum had lots to talk about, their college, and they became friends. His cousin realised that when he visited, it wasn't to see her, it was actually to see Mum. They used to go out because it was summer in 1966, and his cousin realised that they were falling in love. Soon after this, a handful of months passed and Dad asked Mum to marry him. She said yes, but he had to wait a while she did her training. His cousin and her best friend became maid of honour at their wedding with the bridesmaids from the hospital he was working at and for her hospital where she was working. Dad saw it was God's leading and he left Staffordshire and moved to Botley's Park Hospital to work as a qualified mental health nurse and to be near a mum who was working as a qualified general nurse down south, saying that she was worried that if they got together too quickly, she'd get pregnant. And she didn't finish her studies. So she gave him a hard time, basically. it was while he was working at Botley's Park Psychiatric Hospital called Murray House that the two of them decided to have their wedding. So this was in Surrey. Mum was in London attending Holloway Adventist Church. And there was no church in Chertsey or Addlestone, so they decided to get married in Holloway. After the wedding, they moved to Surrey, where in the married quarters at Botley's Park, and then they moved to flats. After Dad's first baby was born, we were rehoused in a house in Newport. Then we moved to Trimble Close in Ottershaw and then Murray House, so we've always stayed in the same area. And then Dad passed away in Addlestone, living in Addlestone. We saw God's leading in their marriage, and with his blessings, the four of us were given to Dad, who used to say, "Happy is the man who has his quiver full of them, they shall not be ashamed." that's Psalms 127, verse 5. So when we were thinking of doing the eulogy, we just talked about our first memories. We asked about our first memories. So Catherine, what was one of your earliest memories of Dad?
My earliest memory of Dad was playing music on a record player. He loved listening to music and singing, especially Jim Reeves, and we were never allowed to touch that record player. I think because that's my earliest memory, that's why I love music and I love singing so much to this day.
Ben, what's the birthday gift that you remember?
I've got a lot of very fond memories, but to touch on perhaps just a couple. A really happy birthday memory that I've got was when our father got me a Lamborghini Miura, a model. Was real. Model of a Lamborghini Miura. And our father he had a lot of interests, lots of hobbies, really diverse range of interests. And I think I got the bug for motorsport, I think, from his interest in cars. But another perhaps earlier memory that I've got is around the fact that he works nights and used to rest during the day. And I was at home with Dad and you guys, Catherine, I don't think you were born yet, and Trudy and James were at school. Mum was at work, and Dad was getting some rest because he used to work nights. And I remember resting with him. I think I woke up and was playing with his beard in bed. I must have been less than five. Lots of very fun.
But you know the car passion that he had. Do you remember when we were kids in the car and he used to keep? Can you imagine four children in the back of the car? They were not there. But he used to get us to tell him what make a car was when he was going past to keep us focused and not fighting. And you remember that?
Yeah.
But now, as a girl, I know all the makes of cars, which is pretty cool. James,
talk
about one of your memories.
I think that the everlasting memory that I have is his love for sport. I can remember one occasion where, I don't remember how old I was, but he was playing cricket and we were watching, or I was watching. I remember him bowling out most of the opposition and then coming into bat and winning all the and scoring all the winning runs as well. And so he almost single-handedly beat the entire opposition's cricket team. But then, from tennis, I played tennis against him once. And I must have been early teens, probably. And we were playing in the park in Uttershaw. And I was quite quick. But Dad was good. So I dropped a shot over the net and won the point off of it. His next serve, though, he served it only about 100 miles an hour and taught me a very important lesson.
So I just remember our family routine. I'm a bit of a stickler for that. And Dad used to just be so hands-on with us. So he'd come in from work at night and we'd be getting ready for school, Mum getting ready for work. He used to drop Mum off at work. I always had to kiss before she left the car. And then he would take us all to school and then he would go home and rest. And then he would come and pick us all up from school. Not always early, would he? Yeah, I just remember that we used to have to wait sometimes when he's coming. And then do the shopping, do the cooking. He's a really, really sort of hands-on dad. And he was always singing. Always singing. And also, like, always correcting us. So, you know, if you didn't pronounce the word very well, or that spelling of Mississippi, M-I-S-S-I-S-S-I-P-I, and he was just, you know, just always teaching us, but not actually realising that he was doing it, or maybe he did, but, yeah, my dad was, he was very hands-on and always wanted us to be learning, and he was always singing, and actually he was always really happy. You know, I don't remember him ever being miserable or down.
Apart from
that, Catherine. Catherine used to annoy me.
I don't know, me being the youngest, being able to, I always used to try to push the boundaries a little bit, well, more than a little bit, and yeah, you get extremely frustrated.
But he always took you everywhere.
But then. He still would do anything for me, regardless.
So, just in conclusion, just one more thing. Do you remember the Hitchhikers? Yeah. But I don't know, back in the day, people used to hitch a lot more than they do now. My dad would always pick them up.
All the time.
So we'd have to squeeze, like there's four children, four of us already, and mum. We have to squeeze up and let this person in that we don't even know might kill us, you know? And we'd be whispering amongst ourselves. But he always did that.
Always.
And homeless people in Shepherd's Bush, you remember that, don't you?
Something I always remember about how generous he was, but also how thoughtful he was. Because he always used to, if a homeless person was begging on the street, he wouldn't ever give them money, but he would take the time to go to the closest shop and buy a cup of tea and a sandwich, and then give that person some food and some drink. And it wasn't until I got older that I realised why. Because you can get money, you can buy anything, you can squander it, but it needs to be in your mind.
So, just a few sort of stories that are more good. So, just in conclusion, he was a sports person, definitely any sport, every sport, bodybuilding, lots of interest, diverse, football, poetry, carpentry, tailoring, singing. He was completely devoted to his family and the church, Slab Church. And he went above and beyond to help anybody that he could. And he's got the trophies to prove it, and the competitive children to show for it. So, as we're here today, all those character traits will live on in all of us.
So my secret. Good afternoon, everyone. afternoon, everyone. It's indeed great to see all of you here this afternoon, supporting this family in this difficult time. Now we're going to have tributes, and the very first tribute will come in the form of a video.
Seven and eight always had a good relationship. He was always gracious and generous. He saw the best in everyone. Never met a stranger, serious about his faith. And the better for having had him as my brother. If no one else sent a birthday card, he did. He will be greatly missed. May the Lord grant special grace to his wife, children, and grandchildren. And may he find peace in God's care. God bless.
Uncle Seven was always cheerful and soft-spoken with us. For a while, he was the uncle we had never seen but heard many great stories from his late mother, affectionately called Mum. She got us all into the habit of anticipating Uncle Seven's handmade birthday and Christmas cards, which were always on time and often included a note. His telephone calls to his maternal household were cherished, as well as the Typhoon and Lipton packages of tea that were sent to each of his siblings' households. Some of us met the godly man in March 1985 when he visited Barbados with his family for the first time since emigrating from Barbados in 1966. Catherine was not around us yet. One of our most memorable moments was when he invited our cousin Philip, a person with a disability, to England in 2008 on his first trip abroad to Catherine's wedding. With him, no one was forgotten. He knew every niece, nephew, and their offspring by name and birthday. So, Uncle Selvin, we won't forget. From all of your nieces and nephews from the United States of America, Canada, and Barbados, rest in peace. Bless.
The next tribute comes to you from Harry Moutien, which says, I met Selvin in 1971 in the mess at Murray House, where we sat at tables. He came over, and from that day, we were friends. He did all sports, but included cricket, and we lived next door to each other in the nursing quarters. I was number seven, and Selvin was number six. After a while, he told me that he was getting married and left Murray House. He then told me that he was expecting his first child, Trudy. I moved to New Hall, and he moved to Duncan Mead Avenue, New Hall. I moved to Tringham Close, and he moved there too. When our children were young, we would go to Black Bush Market every Sunday in December to get toys for our children as presents. I moved to Addlestone, and he moved to Hartmurray Road, and then moved to Addlestone. We always remained friends, never had a cross word. The first time we went to Barbados, we got a trailer for all the kids to hook up to the car. At the airport, Selvin displayed his camera and thought it was lost. On his return, he went to Lost Property, and his camera was there. When he told me he was going to Barbados, I asked him to bring me back some cigarettes. He said, no way, but brought me back sugar cane juice. He always took me to the airport when I went to Mauritius, and I took him when he was flying out. If I was flying out on a Saturday, he would always leave church to take me to the airport and then go back to church. He gave me a Bible. And whenever I was away, he would take Mary to prayer meeting with him on Wednesday evening. This next tribute comes from his cousin, St. Clair, which says, family and mourners, having known Selvin from Bob days as a cousin, he was always polite. I took to school every day, He was always joyful and never upset. He was always admired by both families, as he was always smiling and courteous. As we say goodbye to Selvin, it is nice to see him and knowing him. Rest in peace. The next one comes from Gloria Binami. Selvin shared my grandfather. We were a tribe. He was the first cousin. We used to meet on Sundays and birthdays. We had fun together in our grandparents' home. As teens, we drifted. He joined the Seventh-day Adventist Church. We met up in UK and communicated sometimes. That is my truth. Not a lot, but a relationship was there to me. He was kind and generous always. It seems he was a good husband and father, disciplined. The next tribute comes from our own children. This comes to you from our children who could not be here personally today, namely Virgil, Vernon, Maria, Bates, and Alex. And it says, it comes with heartfelt love and sympathy and thoughtfulness to comfort you during this difficult time and beyond. Those we hold most dear live on in our hearts through the words they said, the love they shared, and the pivotal role they played in our life's journey. To Auntie Ermine, Judy, Tyrone, James and family, Ben and family, Catherine, Kish, and Niall, and all other family members and friends, we wish you peace, the comfort, and healing, courage and strength to face the days ahead, and loving memories to hold dear in your heart forever. Death leaves a heartache no one can heal, but thanks be to our Father God that love, and I repeat, love leaves a memory that no one can steal or that tongue can erase. May the love of God keep you strong and bonded together with patience and understanding as God embraces you all in his almighty arms and surrounds you with his kind of glory as you serve him faithfully. Be comforted today. Lots of love from all of us. And now, Selvin, this one especially for you. There is coming a day when no heartache will come, no more clouds in the sky, no more tears to dim the eyes. All is peace forevermore on that happy golden shore. What a day, a glorious day that will be. There'll be no sorrow there, no more burdens to bear, oh, no more sickness, no more pain, no more body, no more fear. And forever you will be with the one who died for me. Not a day, a glorious day that will be. Oh, what a day that will be. Oh, when you're free, that you will see. Oh, when you love upon his face, the one who said you high and great, and forever you will be. Oh, with the one who died for me. Oh, what a day, a glorious day, oh, God in me. Oh, what a day, a glorious day, that will be. Rest in peace. Rest in peace. And now, because of time, we won't be able to, we won't be able to take tributes from others who might want to do so. But please remember the family in your prayers. And don't forget the phone calls and other things. And now, the final tribute will come to us from no other than the matriarch of the family, our dear loving sister, Ermine.
Do you want the mic?
With the one who died for me. What a day, a glorious day that will be.
Good afternoon, everyone. I just want to say a few words. When I accepted his asked me to marry him, and I was still training as a nurse. And I said, I will give him an answer in a few weeks' time or so. When he asked me again, I said to him, yes, but you need to wait until I finish all my training and the qualifications I need so that I will specialize in what nursing field I want to do. He had to wait 6.5 years on me until I finished everything I wanted to do. He didn't mind, he just accepted. I was living in Hampshire and he was in Staffordshire, but he would come visit at times, and I knew him from Barbados, but I was a cousin of his who joined the set I was in, but I didn't know she was his cousin. So when he decided to come to see her, visit her, then he realized and met me there as well, because in Barbados, we were both students of a private college. Anyway, after I accepted to marry him, he said, I will take you up the following week. He came to take me out for a celebration. And on our way on the street to go for the train, this was Winchester, Hampshire, I was at Lord Mayor Treloar Hospital. So on the high street, we had to go to Alton Station. know, because it was our first, he was taking me out for the first time after accepting him on the street, serving the sign to sing to the top of his voice. She wears my ring to show the world that she belongs to me. To the loud, loud, loud as anything. And I told him, we're serving you on the street. You're not in a home or wherever. You can't be singing that loud. And he said, no, no, you have accepted my offer to marry you, to marry me, and the whole world should know. And he sang all the verses to the top of his voice. Then another occasion, after that occasion singing that song, so he came up with something else. Another time he came to take me out, and this time he sang another song, and he took me by my hands. I was dancing on the side of the road on the so that everyone, he wanted the whole world to know that I would be his wife. There are other occasions that I felt a bit ashamed, but not him. He just out with everything to the loud voice, the whole world must know. Then there was another occasion that was, that one was the ring, and another occasion, and then another time, he this one, now I don't know if he heard about it or if any of you know about it. There was a full moon. This is after marriage and everything and the children. There was a full moon, and he happened to see this full moon. It was really beautiful. And he called me to see the moon in its fullness. I went to see the moon with him, looking through one of the windows. And I said, God bless my eyesight to see that moon again. I don't know if any of you heard that saying. And he said, what? I said, God bless my eyesight to see that moon again. And he asked me, where did you get that from? I told him my paternal grandma taught me to say that from a little child every time I see a full moon. Next time or some other time when he happened to see a full moon and I may be sleeping or whatever, he will come and get me up and take me to see this full moon. Do you know why? Because he wanted to hear me say, God bless my eyesight to see this moon again. And he did it up to 2-3 months ago. Every time a full moon, and he happened to see, and he will have a big grin on his face because he wanted to hear me say, God bless my eyesight to see this moon again. Thank you.
First reading today is taken from John 14, 1-6, and I'll be reading on behalf of Aunt Judy. Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. And whither I go, ye know, and the way ye know. Thomas said unto him, Lord, we know not whither thou goest, and how can we know the way? Jesus said unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Amen. Amen.
This reading is from 1 Thessalonians 4:16 to 18. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. Amen.
Good afternoon, everyone. I give it a privilege to share with you one of Brother Seely's poems. By now you must have known that he wrote them. It says, should I fulfill my allotted 80 years, and then depart leaving my possessions to my kin, I hope they would agree I was a worthy person, and allow their sweet tears to flow at my procession. Although my remains would be on view for all to see, I would not be cognizant of what they say of me. It would be for my family and my former colleagues to defend my good reputation, if you so please. He was always on time when he had to go to work, and when faced with tricky moments, did not shrink. We will miss his smiling face, though some thought it a grim, and was never guilty of administrating spin. He was accomplished most. He has accomplished most of what he set out to do, and might agree that his days were really too few. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I'm sure abiding many will have a for the silly, this is laugh. That smile. Laughter so infectious, I can hear it now. But this poem is taken from a compilation called To Talk About Illnesses. As I sat in the flat, contemplating the end of the year, it suddenly occurred to me with delicacy to prepare. I knew the ingredients needed, is in a house they're not at all. I know pumpkins at my local supermarket, so where could I call? Mm-hmm. I decided to check out the produce in the nearby village, and to my surprise, while there beheld a familiar personage, who did inform me that it was futile to search for pumpkins there. But this, should I wait and follow him, the end of my search could be near. The pumpkin he gave me was a giant weighing 13 kilos, which I did make the congees. I still had plenty left over to share with my friends, family, and acquaintances for quite some time. And the cost of that big pumpkin, to me, was not even a dime.
The song that I'm going to sing is a hymn called "O Love That Will Not Let Me Go." Catherine told me that this was one of Ron Seeley's favourite songs. He loved songs that spoke about the love of God. She also told me that he would expect proper diction, proper pronunciation, all those T's in the song. So I'm going to apologise in advance. My diction is not as impeccable as his would be. But I pray that you still be blessed by this musical tribute of the song "O Love That Will Not Let Me Go." Thank you.
Dear Bereaved family, Sister Irving, Catherine, Shudi, James, and Ben, dear friends, and the rest of the family, everybody else, brothers and sisters, we have gathered here in this quiet moment, this quiet place, to commemorate the life of our brother, husband, father, grandfather, Selman Seely. We are here not to mourn, but to celebrate his life, to remember moments, to bring back the pictures, the moments, the love, the remembrance, as we have been doing so far. And also to give thanks to the life giver, because the greatest gift of all is life that he has given to all of us. The life that he created, and the life that he promises to bring back again one day. So remembering those moments is what we are for. Remembrance of somebody's life is what remains in our memory and imagination, but it is also the legacy, the person that the person has left. Legacy that does not get wiped away even when the person is not around anymore. Remembrance is something that may live as long as the influence of our life lives among people in whichever possible way or form. Selwyn Sylvester Seely might not be a name which you can find necessarily in all history books or here in TV news, read in the newspaper, but this name has been embedded deeply into the life of those ones he lived with and lived for, as we have been able to hear and see a few moments ago. The lives of the loved ones, children, friends, and everybody else that he lived with. Personally, I have known Selwyn as my brother in church for the last 2 years of his life. And during this time, even though I haven't seen him during his prime years of life, I can easily and exactly connect with what I knew and was able to read from his as person, with the photos, with pictures, with memories that the family brought back here. For me, he was somebody who was optimistic and positive about everything, pretty much everything around him. In every situation, that was visible always in his smile, his face expression, and every word that he shared. And no matter of what he might have thought about different other aspects of life, one thing stayed unmoved until the very last moment: his love for Jesus, trusting him, desire to go with him when he comes again, to wake us up from the long sleep and take us all home where we belong. That Jesus' love and living for him, for Jesus, was something that marked the most of Selwyn's life, the 84 years old, long life that I believe most of us can envy him for. Selwyn's faith in Jesus, was for real. And he spent most of his life helping others to also benefit from it, from faith in Jesus. And because he was so confident in his trust in Jesus, the promise of eternal life, I'm also confident to say Selwyn's death is nothing but a sleep, according to the promise found in the Word of God, which is found in 1 Corinthians 15. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruit of those who have fallen asleep. For as in Adam all die, so also in Christ shall all be made alive. Sister Irvin, one day you will be with your husband again. And that day is not far away. The day when you will be able to again take him by the hand, walk with him, run with him. Wait for the moments which you still have and will always have as long as you live and over this life as well, in your memory, as happy moments. But the moments that will follow will be even happier, even more real and more blessed. God has promised, and he will deliver, that when he comes again, he will take wise our brother Selwyn, together with many of those who have lived for Jesus and with Jesus, truly believing in him, and take us all home to where we belong to. And it's, as it says in 1 Thessalonians 4:16 to 18, for the Lord himself will be sent from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And thus we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words, because these words are true. Amen. I invite us all to take part in praying the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, now and forevermore. Amen.
Can we please rise for the closing hymn? And feel the truth.
sings my soul, all my Savior.
Us, you're the one who redeemed us and the one who is coming again soon to take us home. Lord, thank you for the life of our brother Selvin, through whom you have blessed so many around him, the family, the friends, the colleagues, so many people. Thank you, Lord, for these blessings in his life. Lord, I pray for the family, especially for Sister Erin, who is the witness of your blessing. And I ask, Lord, to help us all, give us that energy and perseverance, never to get weary of walking with you and waiting for the moment which is coming soon, when we will indeed, according to your firm promise, meet again when you raise those ones who have died, and bring those ones who are around, scattered. Bring us to happy life, to live with one another, with you and with the thousands in the happy land, with happy people. Lord, help us all to remain that light who is shining and reflecting your light around us to everybody until the moment comes. Amen. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
For you, it's more. I've never sung that song by myself before. I actually whispered words in the middle of.